So in this lesson, we'll cover the general types of problems that RatStats is able to solve. So you might have downloaded RatStats, opened it up, and said, all right, I want to solve a problem. Maybe pull a sample, analyze some results, but then quickly got lost by clicking through the many, many menus and options within those menus. I guess there's only four menus, that's not too bad. Then maybe you went to the website and clicked on the two help guides, which are extremely thorough, but I think contain about 700 pages. So as daunting that this might seem, you don't need most of these options for most of the things that you need to do on a day-to-day basis. Moreover, for most problems that you'd want to solve, RatStats is relatively straightforward to use. So thinking about a big picture, we can say, what happens if we want to pull a sample? What do we need to do first? Or what steps do we need to take? So the first thing we want to do is decide on a sample design. Well, RatStats won't really help you that much with that. Other than in some cases, specific cases, it can help you decide on a sample size. Now, this is a sort of a big word of caution, is folks often want the sample size determination to sort of be rote. Sort of look in the back of a book and a table and get the number you want to pull. And it doesn't quite work that way. Some of the information you have to provide to get a sample size is rather substantial. We're not going to go into detail on that today, but I will touch upon that piece. Once you've gotten your sample design and a sample size, you're going to need to actually select your sample. And that's where the random numbers piece comes in. So we've already covered in lesson one the single stage random number generator. It turns out that RatStats has a lot of random number generators, but for almost all the cases that happen in day-to-day healthcare audits and internal reviews, the single stage random number generator is sufficient. So now you've pulled your random numbers, and as we talked about in the lesson one, once you pull your random numbers, you are responsible for then matching those random numbers back to your sampling frame. You've got your sample items, you go, you review them all, come back with your results, and now the exciting time to actually calculate your statistical estimate. All right, so how do we calculate our statistical estimate? Well, that's where these appraisal modules come in. We've got the attribute appraisal module and the variable appraisal module. So, of course, the question that often comes up is, what's the difference between an attribute appraisal and a variable appraisal? Well, an attribute appraisal is any situation where what you're measuring for your sample items is sort of a yes-no situation. It is correct, it isn't correct. Was a document signed, the document wasn't signed. Was a claim filed correctly, not filed correctly. So if you sort of imagine that your results can be reduced to, how many of this occurred in my sample? Oh, out of my sample of 100, 50 were not signed. So if your results can be reduced in that simple manner, then the attribute appraisal menu is where you want to be. Conversely, suppose what you have is items, and for each item, you have a number associated with it. So you pull transaction one and you find it's perfect. So there's nothing wrong with it. Pull transaction two, nothing wrong with it. Pull transaction three and you find out it was under billed by $20. Well, notice in this case, what we're interested in is not the number of transactions that are overbilled or underbilled, but the actual dollar associated with each transaction. Now, it doesn't have to be dollar for it to be very appraisal. It's any time that your coding of the results isn't simply the number of times something occurred, the number of sample items for something occurred. It's actually a number associated with each sample item. The most common situation is dollar values. So again, to recap, the first thing we generally want to do is we want to decide on a sample size. And if you actually notice, the sample size determination option has a variable and an attribute option as well, and these equate to the same concept. So if you're going to estimate the number of items in the frame that have a particular attribute, then you'd use an attribute sample size determination. If you want to estimate the total dollar value in the frame or some other quantity, then you'd use a variable size. Once I had a design, I'd go to random numbers. We've already talked about the simple single-stage random number is by far the most common generator. We already have a lesson for that posted. That's lesson one. And then when you analyze your results, you're going to use either the attribute or variable appraisal lessons, depending. One final point I want to note is there's a lot of options, of course, within the attribute and variable appraisals. Frankly, 97% of the designs, I made that number up, but a lot of the designs that I've seen are either unrestricted or stratified. So there's a lot of options here, but most people just use the top two. And we'll have other lessons for each of the most common tools that we'll post later on. But I just want to give a broad overview so you sort of know what you've got to handle, and you're not staring at a 700 guide or 30 odd buttons to click with having absolutely no clue where to start.